forms of corruption. The next chapter, chapter 22. باب ما جاء في حماية المصطفى صلى الله عليه وسلم جناب التوحيد وسده كل طريق يوصل أو يوصل إلى الشرك. Chapter, the protectiveness of المصطفى, meaning the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, the chosen one. المصطفى صلى الله عليه وسلم, the protectiveness of المصطفى صلى الله عليه وسلم of توحيد, and his blocking every path leading to shirk. That the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, with his actions, with his ahadith, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made him protect the tawheed, the oneness of worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he blocked every path that would lead to what negates the tawheed, which is shirk. So you would find this clearly in the deen of Allah. Anything that would lead to this worst sin, even if it's from far away, even if people do not see the relationship between both of how it leads to such a disaster, you would find it forbidden in the deen of Allah, as we will see from these evidences, as he would mention. He mentioned the verse, وَقَوْلُ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى لَقَدْ جَاءَكُمْ رَسُولٌ مِّنْ أَنفُسِكُمْ عَزِيزٌ عَلَيْهِ مَا عَنِتُّمْ حَرِيصٌ عَلَيْكُمْ بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ رَؤُوفٌ رَحِيمٌ فَإِن تَوَلَّوْا فَقُلْ حَسْبِيَ اللَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا هُوَ عَلَيْهِ تَوَكَّلْتُ وَهُوَ رَبُّ الْعَرْشِ الْعَظِيمِ. Verily, there has come unto you a messenger, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, from amongst yourselves. It grieves him that you should receive any injury or difficulty. He, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is anxious over you to be rightly guided and so on. For the believers, full of pity, kind and merciful. But if they turn away, say, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah is sufficient for me. لا إله إلا هو, meaning none has the right to be worshipped but he. In him I put my trust and he is the Lord of the mighty throne. So this ayah shows how the Prophet ﷺ had the concern for his ummah. The concern that they are saved, the concern that they stay on the straight path, the concern that they would stay on the tawheed, on the oneness of worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because this is the most important thing in one's religion, the first pillar of Islam. Why this ayah is mentioned here, clearly it shows how the Prophet ﷺ was towards his ummah. So as a result of that, you would find the Prophet ﷺ protected this ummah from falling into the tawheed, into the shirk, if they would obey the Prophet ﷺ. If they would submit themselves to the Prophet ﷺ and his orders, they would never fall into the shirk. تَرَكْتُ فِيكُمْ مَا إِن تَمَسَّكْتُمْ بِهِ فَلَن تَضُلُّ بَعْدِ أَبًا. I leave among you two things, that if you hold fast to it, you would never be led astray. كتاب الله وسنتي, the book of Allah and my sunnah. These two things, if a person hold fast to it, then he would never fall into the things that would negate لا إله إلا الله محمد رسول الله. What negates لا إله إلا الله is the shirk. What negates محمد رسول الله is the bid'ah and innovation in the religion. What do we learn from this verse, or these two verses? That the Prophet ﷺ definitely warned his ummah from shirk. And we heard that in the previous chapter. And the Prophet ﷺ made for those who follow him, they made him, he made them far away from shirk if they would follow the Prophet ﷺ. Also, another benefit for us to see the bounty of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala unto the human beings that he sent the Messenger of Allah Muhammad ﷺ to take them out from darkness to the light of the Tawheed and the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also, as he mentions here also in the explanation, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala praised the lineage of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, that he was sent from among them, meaning among the Arab, and he was from among the best of the lineage and so on. And his pity alayhi salatu wasalam and kindness and merciful towards the believers. And this by itself, it doesn't matter what time that you live in, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam cared for his ummah. So everything has been saved for us. Everything that would get us closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Prophet ﷺ had ordered us to do it. Everything that would get the person away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Prophet ﷺ had warned his ummah from it. So the matter is completed and perfected. And those who innovate in the religion of Islam, as if with their actions, they're claiming that there is some deficiencies in the deen, that we need to complete these deficiencies by inventing matters of worship and things that was never present at the time of the Prophet ﷺ. Even if they don't say that with their tongues, but their actions would speak louder than their speeches. So it's very important that we follow and we humble ourselves in following the way of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. And the job of the ulama is to make the people follow the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, not to invent new things with them. The hadith mentioned in the chapter, يقول عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم لا تجعلوا بيوتكم قبورا ولا تجعلوا قبري عيدا وصلوا علي فإن صلاتكم تبلغني حيث كنتم. He said عليه الصلاة والسلام, and if you ponder over these meanings you would see how the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم by his words protecting the tawheed, the oneness of worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He said, do not make your homes graves. Do not make my grave a place of celebration. Eid. Send your salah, blessings, graces, honors and mercy on me. Your salah will be conveyed to me wherever you may be. And this is an authentic hadith reported by Abu Dawood, and the narrators are trustworthy. So here the Prophet والسلام, saying, لا تجعلوا بيوتكم قبورا, meaning do not make your homes graves, meaning there is no worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in it. There is no salah in it. Because if you don't make salah in your homes, meaning the optional salah, for men they make the obligatory salah in the masajid. So if they pray in the masajid, then they might not pray anything in their homes. So the Prophet ﷺ is telling them, do not make your homes like graves. Graves, there is no worship in the graves. So this is by itself is an evidence that graves are not to be worshipped, of course. Graves is not places to be having the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the grave or by the grave. The grave is places where people are buried and that's it. Not a places of worship. And he said alayhi salatu wasalam, وَلَا تَجْعَلُوا قَبْرِي عِيدًا. عِيدًا meaning do not make my grave as عيد. What is عيد? عيد is we call عيد الفطر, عيد الأضحى, right? Holiday. But the literal meaning of it, the linguistic meaning of it, it's something that is repeated. Right, something that happens once a year, once a week, right? The Jumu'ah is our weekly Eid because it keeps coming every week. Eid al-Fitr, it's called Eid because it comes once every year. So it's something that is celebrated, and the celebration meaning that there is a special day, one day a year, this is by itself a celebration, even if you don't do nothing in that day, right? If you just observe it as a day in the year, then this is called Eid, something that is getting reported over and over again. So the Prophet ﷺ is forbidding his ummah to make his grave a place of Eid, a place of celebration, a place of festivity, a place where you continuously, all the time, going to it, going to it, going to it, especially if a person is by the grave of the Prophet ﷺ. And that is to block all the ways to matters of shirk, so that people do not call unto the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and instead they should call unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why Imam Malik rahimahullah and others, the ulama in general, they would forbid the person, those who already in the Medina of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, that every time they go to the masjid of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they go to the grave. This is something that should not be done. Someone comes from far away traveling, after he prays, he starts with the salah of course, and then he can visit the grave of the Prophet ﷺ. Visiting the grave of the Prophet ﷺ definitely is a good thing, and to say salam to the Prophet ﷺ as he ordered us, right? But, and then after that a person should not every salah he go visit the grave, every salah he should go visit the grave. This is something, even if the Muslim wants to do that, because we love the Prophet ﷺ, but this is where it comes the following and the submission in place, that we listen to what the Prophet ﷺ said, even if a person tends to like to do something else, but we are nothing but slaves of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if someone might think that the ones that would go continuously or frequently to the grave of the Prophet ﷺ, they would have more blessings, the Prophet ﷺ said, وَصَلُّوا عَلَيْهِ, and make salah unto me. When you say salah, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad, till the end, you're making dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he blesses and honors and praises the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. So you can do that anywhere. As the Prophet said, وَصَلُّوا عَلَيْهِ فَإِنَّ صَلَاتَكُمْ تَبْلُغُونِ حَيْثُ كُنْتُمْ. That means it reaches me wherever you are. It doesn't have to be that you have to be physically in a certain place. Anywhere. If you do it, it reaches the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, which shows this is a great benefit. And it is the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Any place on the face of earth, you need to make salah on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it reaches him. That there is no special reward for being close to the grave of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, that any place you can make salah unto the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. Also it shows that to travel, we need to travel to Al-Madinah, to the masjid of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, because this is where the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said that it's only permissible to travel into the three masajid, the masjid al-haram in Mecca, and the masjid of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, and the masjid in Jerusalem, masjid al-Aqsa. These are the three masajid that has virtuousness in itself, that you can travel just to be in the masjid. Any other masjid, you have to have another reason. You have a dars, a lecture, for example, or something else. There's no virtues in any other masjid on the face of earth that you would go travel to it, like some people go to the masajid where they think, for example, Prophet Hud is buried, and they would travel to Yemen, for example, to visit this grave. Or they believe that Al-Hussein, the grandson of the Prophet ﷺ, is buried in a certain masjid, so they travel far distances to his masjid. All of these things are innovation in the religion. People go and they commit shirk and they call unto other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They have field trips. They take them for trips to these places where the Prophet ﷺ said only three masajid, they have virtues in which a person would travel to them. And it shows clearly how the Prophet ﷺ protected the tawheed. When people do not do that, meaning what? Their needs, their urges, they turn to who? To Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. Not to anyone, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. Because why people do that by the grave of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? They seek help. And they need to seek the help from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, and none but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And again, the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, none of them would ever do such a thing. Actually, they forbid people from the opposite. As it comes into the next tradition mentioned here, he says, وعن علي بن الحسين أنه رأى رجلا يجيء إلى فرجة كانت عند قبر النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فيدخل فيها فيدعو, فنهاه وقال ألا أحدثكم حديثا سمعته من أبي عن جدي عن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال لا تتخذوا قبري عيدا ولا بيوتكم قبورا وصلوا علي فإن تسليمكم يبلغني أين كنتم. علي بن الحسين, right? علي بن الحسين and Ibn Ali Ibn Abi Talib, you know, and we know that he is the nephew of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, right? So he is the great grandson of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam himself. He saw a man at a space that was at the grave of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam, and he would go in it and supplicate. He saw a man going into a space by the grave of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he'd go in there and he would make dua. So he, meaning Ali ibn al-Husayn, prevented the man and instructed him, saying, when he saw him doing this, he prevented him. And he told him, should I not tell you a hadith which I heard from my father, who in turn heard it from my grandfather, Ali radiallahu anhu, who reported from Allah's Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said, do not take my grave as a place of celebration. The same hadith that we heard earlier, do not take my grave as a place of Eid celebration, nor your homes as graves. Make salah upon me, for your salutation will be conveyed to me from wherever you are. Salam to the Prophet ﷺ, that you ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for safety for the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, that would reach the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Zain al-Abidin himself, which is, that's Ali ibn al-Husayn, he's saying that this is how they learned the way of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam from one generation to the other, forbidding someone when he saw him doing such a thing, that a lot of Muslims, they would wish to do the same thing, right? And he forbade them from this. And he mentioned the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, do not make my grave as a place of worship. So again, this is clearly mentioned that it's not permissible to make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by the grave of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, thinking that this spot has more virtues in making dua than any other spot. But what is permissible for us to do when we go to the grave of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam is to make salam to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and we pass. Make salam to Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu and to Umar radiallahu anhuma, and we pass. There's no standing there and looking and making dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Of course, making dua to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam is shirk. But if even someone makes dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala there, this is not the way of the companions radiallahu anhum. They would forbid people from doing that. Imagine this man was making dua to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This becomes a disaster. But he was making dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he still forbade him from such a thing. So this is the purpose of our visiting of the grave of the Prophet ﷺ, is to say the salam. And even that reaches the Prophet ﷺ from any place. So when a person is going for Hajj or Umrah, people say, don't forget to give my salam to the Prophet ﷺ. There is no such a thing. The Sahaba radiallahu anhu didn't do that to one another. Right? You can do that right here. You can do that right here. And it reaches the Prophet ﷺ. And this is the mercy of Allah. So this is clearly mentioned in this tradition. This is the end of chapter 22.